I'm as much struggling as anybody else on this planet to get to know Him. All of us know of God. We all know of God. But the key question is, do we know God? It doesn't matter what your religion is, what your faith is, that is the biggest struggle. Do we know God? Do we have a personal relationship with God? Do we relate to God? Do we communicate with God? Do we have a relationship with God? That is what it means to know God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that the only reason why He has created sentient beings, like human beings and jinns, is for nothing except to worship Him. We have been created only to worship Him. And how can we worship that which we do not know? So the first step towards worship, the first step towards submission is to know who you're worshiping to, who you are submitting to. In every prayer, the Muslim prayer is not valid unless you recite the first chapter of the Quran, Surah Al-Fatiha. And in that prayer, Muslims always pray that we pray only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we pray only to God. So I'm going to make an attempt at that. Muslims know God in three ways. One, by observing His creation. This creation is a reflection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So by observing His creation, and in the Quran He has invited Muslims and all believers to reflect on His signs. The second thing that we do is by listening to His words. Muslims believe that the entire Quran, every single word in the Quran is the revealed word of God. And so when we listen to the Quran, and in fact the first word that was revealed was Iqra, is to listen. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. To read and recite. And so the second way of doing is through that. But the third and perhaps the most profoundest way in which Muslims and maybe people from other faiths have also tried to know God, to worship God, is through zikr, is through remembrance of God, the constant remembrance of God. Today I'm going to try and do it two ways. I will share with you what Muslim scholars in the past have said about God, about knowing God. And I will also share with you what God Himself has said about Himself. As Muslims, those who are the followers of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we feel very fortunate that in our scripture, God has revealed so much about Himself. He has shared with us His attributes. He has shared with us His essence. We know Him by His names. We know Him by His essence. We know Him by His realities. We know Him by His preferences. And at some point, He has shared with us even His secrets. One of the biggest goals of all Muslims is to become one from those who know, min al-arifin, to know from among those who know. So I'm going to recite to you 9 verses first from chapter 55 in the Quran. And you will see how God has revealed Himself to His believers in this chapter. A'udhu billahi Ar-Rahman, allama al-Qur'an, khalaqa al-insan, allamahu al-bayan, ash-shamsu wal-qamru bihusban, wan-najmu wash-shajru yasjudan, was-samaa'a رفعها ووضع الميزان ألا تدغوا في الميزان وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا يقصروا الميزان. is a long surah. There is a reason why I picked only the first 9 verses, and you will understand when I translate it. This surah begins with a sentence which is just one word. It says, Ar-Rahman, the most merciful. This is the greatest attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the greatest characteristics. So it's like if God is introducing himself to us and is giving us his business card, he's saying, Ar-Rahman, I am the most merciful, the most benevolent. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed. So this is how we know. The word, the Arabic language is very interesting. It's a little bit like mathematics, especially based on verbs. You can actually make up to 58 different words from one word. So when the Arabs heard this for the first time, they had never heard the word Rahman, that they could understand the word because of the logic of the language. So it was, for those who were listening to this word for the first time, mind-blowing, even to those who spoke the language itself. That is an important part, so you can understand the power of the text. And God says, Allama al-Qur'an, he's the one who taught you Qur'an. Khalaq al-insan, he is the one who created humanity. Allamahu al-bayan, not only did he create humanity, but he taught humanity how to express itself. How to express itself, not just to talk, to think, to read, to emote. And why did he teach people the capacity to do bayan, to express? Because he wanted us to be empowered to express our love, our devotion, and submission for him. That is why he gave us the capacity to do bayan. Just as he created for the sole purpose of worshipping him, he gave us the capacity to express ourselves for the sole purpose that we express our submission for him and for his love, and for his mercy, and for his grace. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Ash-shamsu wal-khamru bi-husban. Look at the heavens and the earth. They are all very precisely created. It's very interesting that he immediately turns towards describing his creation and looks at it and see, look at the balance that I have created in this universe. They're all perfectly tuned. They never go out of sync. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and the stars and the trees also worship me. And the heaven, he says, look at the heaven. Look at it, how I have created a balance. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that this entire creation that I have created has something which has balance in it. And then, after these 7 verses of introduction, he makes a kalam. And he says, but do not transgress this balance. Allah tadghaw fil mizan. Do not transgress or violate this balance that exists in nature. For those Muslims who think that God has not commanded us to take care of the environmental crisis, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. I've created this ecosystem with a balance. Don't ruin that balance. But it's more to it. He's saying, وَأَخِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْخِسْتِ وَلَا تُقْصِرُ الْمِزَانِ. And he says, and establish what is right in justice, and do not make a society which is deficient in balance. Many commentators have only used this in the literal sense and saying that if you are a shopkeeper, you should not cheat while you are selling things. That's not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. He's saying, just as I created this entire universe with a balance that is just, I want you to create your societies where social justice prevails. وَخِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْخِسْتِ وَلَا تُقْصِرُ الْمِزَانِ. So establish justice in your society and do not create imbalance. Do not create inequalities between genders, between races, between religious people, between the rich and the poor, between the old and the young. The sad tragedy in Florida is now reminding us that we have never paid much attention to the rights of those who are children and young. This is an important part. So for Muslims, as a Muslim, I feel fortunate that God has empowered us with words and opportunities to know Him. But I also lament the tragedy that we often forget that. People who focus on religion, people who talk about Islam, 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 all the time, Islam will dominate, Islam is better than communism, Islam is better than socialism, Islam is better than democracy, better than... I don't know why they are talking about Islam as if they have done talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can we? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that if all these oceans and the rivers had become ink and all the trees were pens, then we would still not be able to stop describing His glory. If all the rivers and oceans that exist were ink and all the trees were pens, we would not be able to exhaust the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which means that just to talk about God and how glorious He is, one lifetime is not enough. And we take time from that, literally and philosophically turning our back to God to talk about other things, including religion. It is when we turn our back to God that man-made gods become powerful. When you say, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Sunni, I'm a Shia, I'm a Salafi, I'm a Sufi, when you start, these are not identities with which God knows you. God knows you as someone who's truly submitted or someone who's struggling to submit. And someone who is unfortunate, who has not yet realized that he has to submit. Let me tell you, in the Quran, at least three places God says that everything in the heaven and the earth has submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no disbeliever in creation. There are those who are aware that they have submitted to God and are fortunate enough to enjoy the pleasure that comes from submission to God. And there are those who do not recognize that they have already submitted to the will of God. You were born when God wanted you to be born. You will die when He wants you to die. You can accept Him, you can reject Him, you can worship Him, you can forget Him, no matter what. Your essence has already submitted to Him like everything else in the universe. So, how do we know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There is one verse in the Quran, in the 24th surah, verse 35. It's very long. I'm just going to talk about the first part, and that's self-profound enough. I could talk all day about just the first part. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allah nur samawati wal ard. Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. That's another way in which Allah describes Himself. You want to know who Allah is? Read the Quran. He's telling you who He is. He's giving you His CV, His biodata, all the links are there. Just click on them. So what does it mean to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the light of the heavens and the earth? And in the same verse, he also uses a very fascinating phrase called Nurun ala Nur. He's light upon light. So what does it mean to say that He's light upon light? So you have to understand that the word light is being used both in the physical sense and in the epistemological sense. When you say, if there is darkness, you say, turn the light on. You actually need to have light so you can see. Without light, nobody can see. If this universe was in darkness, we wouldn't know whether we were blind or not. So when Allah says that He is the light of the heavens and the earth, that means this universe presents itself and becomes apparent because of the light of God. And without the light of God, this universe will not exist because it will be in the darkness of an unexistence, if you can imagine that concept. It will be in darkness. So that is one way in which God sheds light upon creation. The second way in which we understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the light of heavens and the earth is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I take people, when they believe in me, I take them. Yukhrijum min al-zulumati ila an-nur. I take them out of darkness into enlightenment. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, I'm taking you out of darkness into light, it doesn't mean that I'm turning the switch on. What he's saying is that I'm clearing the clutter in your head and in your heart. I'm enlightening you by making you aware of my existence and making you recognize the mercy and the compassion that I have expressed on you, and also giving you the opportunity to worship me. Nobody is doing any favors to God. He doesn't need us. Never needed us, he will never need us. We exist by his mercy. If we spent our entire life just thanking him for this existence, because it is only because of this existence that we know of his existence. It is only because of this existence that he has given to us out of mercy and love that we know of his existence, and there is nothing greater than knowing him. Without that, we would know nothing. He doesn't need us. In the Islamic history, there is a guy called Mullah Nasruddin. He's a Sufi, he's a clown, he's a scholar. It's not very clear what he is. Sometimes he says things which are very profound, sometimes he says things which are very silly. And if you are smart, you will realize that even the silly things he says are also very profound. So it was a way in which mystical scholars try to express profound truths in very simple terms. And he made me understand, through a joke, how we are all worth nothing. One day Mullah Nasruddin is in the hammam. Hammam is the traditional bathroom where you just wear a towel and nothing else, and you go and you get sauna, and then you go into cold water and hot water. Those of you who have been fortunate to travel in Turkey and Morocco, you will realize that there is a lot of tourism associated with these hammams. So Mullah Nasruddin was in one of these hammams, sitting there in his towel, and of all people, Tamerlane, the conqueror, walks into that hammam. Tamerlane conquered from western Turkey all the way to Delhi. He controlled most of the world that was worth controlling at that time, a great conqueror. He sits there in his towel and looks at Mullah Nasruddin, recognizes him and says, "Ya Mullah, if I was a slave, how much would you pay to buy me? If I was a slave and you could buy me, how many pieces of gold would you give to buy me?" The Mullah looks at him as if he's assessing his value. Yeah, trying that with Timurlane, one of the most cruel persons on earth. And he says, "I will give you 2 pieces of gold for you." 2 pieces of gold. Timurlane is really stunned, because Timurlane himself owned probably 2 million pieces of gold. He would come with all this territory. You would be king of Persia and Iraq and Turkey if you had Timurlane. He says, "Come on, are you kidding me? This towel that I'm wearing, that towel itself is worth 2 pieces of gold." So Mullah said, "Yeah, that was the price." So the only thing he found of value was the towel and not Tamerlane. And it's obviously intended as a joke, but what he planned to say was, "No, you are the slave of God. A, you're not for sale. And B, we are all absolutely nothing." Yeah. So that is an important part to understand the greatness. It is very difficult to constantly, I can keep talking in an abstract sense, but let me give an example. Muslims believe that God has revealed 2 books to us. One book is the creation, and the other book is the Quran and the Torah and the Injil, the Bible, and the Psalms of David. These are all God's revelations for Muslims. So if you look at the universe, there are billions and billions of suns and stars. And in the universe, time and space become one. We measure space through time. by saying you are 1 million years away. It's a mind-boggling thing. Can we understand that in our lifetimes? No. I don't think any human being may develop ever the intellectual capacity to comprehend the entire universe. And the entire universe is just a mere reflection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He just created it. It is not even equal, na'uzu billah, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's just one thing like you and me, worthless. That He has created just to give you an indication of how great He is. We could spend our entire lifetime trying to understand the universe, if possible. But what you and I can do is go into the backyard, take a telescope, look at the sky, and be in a state of wow. Wow, look at the greatness of the universe. And that is how you ought to be towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I said, wow. Ya Allah, Allahu Akbar, and go down in sujood and prostrate and never come out. That is what it means to recognize the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of you know about David, King David, we call him Prophet Dawood alayhi salam. One day, Prophet Dawood alayhi salam asked God, why did you create this entire creation? What was the purpose of the creation of creation? And God's answer is one of the very hotly debated hadith al-Qudsi in Islamic tradition. This is what he said. He said, "Kundu kanzan makfiya fa ahbabtu an arafa fa khalaqta al khalaq likay ya'raf." He said that I was a hidden treasure. I loved to be known, and therefore I created the creation in order to be known. Elsewhere he says, "I was a hidden treasure. I wanted to be loved, and therefore I created beings." Sentient beings who have the capacity to know and to love so that we can know and love it. There's a huge debate about it. People say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a harani. He is without a need. He doesn't need anything. But that is not how we are talking about. This is His manifestation. He created the creation to know Himself. When we say Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth, without His light we cannot know. And in reality we never know. It is Allah who knows Himself through us, and we know Him and ourselves through Him. That's a little difficult, but ponder over it. Because it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is all-knowing. The capacity to know is in God. He has given us some of it. And that's why we can know ourselves and we can know Him. So our capacity to know God is also a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the most profoundest thing. We can know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His names. And that is why He has shared His name. But most importantly, we can know Him through what He has said in the Quran. There is one verse in the Quran which is according to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the most important verses in the Quran. It is called Ayatul Kursi. It is verse 255 from the second chapter of the Quran. I will recite it very quickly and share its meaning with you. And then I will also recite three more verses from the 59th chapter of the Quran in which God tells us about Himself. God talks to us about Him. He talks to us. But you must understand that God tells us very clearly in the Quran, Laysa kamithlihi. There is nothing like God. And because there is nothing like God, we can never actually really know Him. So in order to know Him, God has to have things out there which are kind of like Him. So that we may know those things which are like Him in order to be able to understand Him. Like the love of your mother. So God says, you know the love of your mother, how selfless she is, how sacrificing she is for you. Now you take that and say, extrapolate it 19 infinite times and say, okay, God's love for me is like that. So that is why we know God through things that are like him, but not exactly like him, definitely not in proportion, so lacrimously. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created his parameters, his names, and his essences through which we get a sense of how God is. And that is the whole purpose of life, is to remember him through his name. So some of the, he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the Surah Ayatul Kursi, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يئوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم. Now in this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just one word, it's one sentence literally. It's not also the longest sentence, by the way, in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah, he's the one, he, Allah is one who is ever living and ever sustaining. There is no one but him who is God. Allah, la ilaha illahu. There is no God except him. And he is Hayyul Qayyum. He is the one who is ever living, and he is the one on the basis of which everything exists. He is Qayyum. Without him, nothing can exist. It was based perhaps on this verse that both Aristotle and Ibn Sina tried to combine the heavens and the earth. When the Quran says Samawat wal Ard, it doesn't mean sky and earth. It means the spiritual world and the material world. So all the sky is part of the earth. What is Ilmul Ghaib, the spiritual world, is Samawat. So both Ibn Sina and Aristotle try to argue that everything has a cause. You're having a storm because there is a hurricane. The hurricane is there because there is a low pressure area. There is low pressure area. There is high tide. So there is a cause for everything in nature. So if you understand the physical world, there is a causal relationship between things. But in the metaphysical world, it's different. How do angels exist? And why are they invisible? So both Aristotle and Ibn Sina tried to connect the two by saying God is the first cause and he caused everything else. His existence is necessary and undependent on anything but himself. But it is so simple here. Allah la ilaha illahu huwa al-hayyul qayyum. He is ever existing. And he's the one who has established existence. I don't know why we have to waste so much time writing so many books when God said this in just two words. And that is the importance of it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala later says, and I don't have the time to go over all of this, but I do want, for the sake of barakah, to recite his names. So I would like you to go and take a look at these verses, 255 of chapter 2. Verses 22 to 24 from chapter 59. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Huwa alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-alim al-ghaybi wa al-shahada huwa al-Rahman ar-Rahim. Huwa alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-malik al-quddus al-salam al-mu'min al-muhaymin al-aziz al-jabbar al-mutakabbir. Subhanallahi amma yushrikun. هو الله الخالق الباري المصور له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم. اللهم صل على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. The verse 255 is essentially the greatest verse in the Quran by some reports. But the chapter 112, Surah Al-Ikhlas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, or Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, is one third of the Quran. So if you are smart, recite this surah three times before you sleep. It is like reciting the entire Quran before you sleep. The surah is very beautiful. It says, in many ways, essentially describes God and his essence to us. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Qul huwallahu ahad. Say that Allah is one. Qul huwallahu ahad. Say that Allah is one. Allahu samad. He is one that is eternal, and he is one that makes everything success. Lam yalid walam yulad walam yakul lahu kufuwan. He is not being created by anybody. He is not begotten by anyone. He does not beget anyone. He does not create anyone in the way we do. And walam yakul lahu kufuwan. And there is nothing equal to him. He is one. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he gives all of us an opportunity to know about him. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that in this world where there is so much violence, so much hatred, so much anger, I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes our eyes off this world so that we may look towards the heavens. We pray to him that may be given the opportunity to remember him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu uzkuru Allaha zikran kaseeran, O you who believe, remember me excessively. I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the opportunity, the practice, the blessing to remember him excessively. Rabbana atayna fi dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina adhaban nar. Inna Allaha ya'muru bil adli wal ihsani wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghyi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun. Wa aqimus salah.
Excuse yourself, we are having a student guest today. We might not have enough space. Please come. Don't worry, standing on the carpet line. Just squeeze, please. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله Thank you. سمع الله لمن حمده ربنا الله اكبر
الله اكبر
الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
Thank you, and welcome to all of you. Can I have Jay and Terry, why don't you join us on the panel? So you can keep an eye on them.
Check Jason for love as well.
Brother Abdullah, can you join Sister Aisha? We are not going to have any speeches or any talks. We're just going to, this is just a panel which is here to answer any and all questions that you have to ask. I will remind the panelists that it's snowing and raining and these guys have to go home, so we'll try our best to keep the answers brief and not use that as an opportunity to tell you our life stories, which are very long, since you can see some of us are above 50. It will take at least 50 minutes. I begin with a short prayer. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahmani rahim. Maliki yawm al-deen. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta alayhim. Ghayril maghdubi alayhim wa lad-dallin. Amin. So I'm going to start with that. And go ahead. Who wants to have the first question? Go ahead. Tell us your name just so we may remember. And bear witness on the day of judgment that you asked a good question.
So you mentioned that. My name's Andy. You mentioned that Allah created man to worship him. Why did Allah create the rest of the world?
There's a verse in the Quran that says that God, everything in the heavens and the earth worships God. There's another verse which says, even the birds who are flying worship God. And you may not be able to see that, but people are always worshiping God. So when I said, I didn't say man actually, if you notice, the Quran's verse is ins were jinns, or human beings and jinns. But I translated it as sentient beings. Beings that are capable, because I was also understanding the other verses of the Quran, where we know that everything, heavens and the earth, even the earth worships. There is one very important, beautiful episode where Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was passing by a grave, and he looked around and he saw a piece of a leaf or a flower, and he put it on the grave, and they moved on, and people asked, why did he do that? He said, well, the guy who was dead was being punished by angels for sins he had committed, but I noticed that that leaf was remembering God, so I put the leaf on the grave, and until the leaf remembers God, the angels are going to keep quiet and not punish that person. So it was a way of him telling that even leaves. So don't disturb nature unnecessarily, because everything is in a state of worship.
My name is Dustin. Why are depictions of Muhammad considered blasphemous?
Why are the depictions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam considered blasphemous? Sister, you want to take that?
Thank you so much for your question. I don't know that I'm the best person to answer, to be honest, but I will say we don't really know what Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam looked like, and we don't want to attribute to him characteristics that we don't know that he had. We don't have, you know, pictures, we don't have a vision of what the man looked like. So if I were to give a picture and it were as he or as he or as he, then we would have this false vision of who he was, and that we would attribute height and maybe good looks or not, or charm, to how he looked, and that's really not what it's about. Just as eye cover, you can't really see what I look like. You have to judge me by who I am and by my actions. You don't judge me by what I look like. So it's very similar in that.
Actually, when you go home, look at the Ten Commandments, you're forbidden to create engraven images, and so are Muslims and Christians and Jews were forbidden to create images of God. I think that's probably what Abdullah was trying to say. I'll take the next question. Go ahead. Say that again? Seeding logic. The logic of elder. You want to take that, Brother Abdullah?
Well, thank you for the question. This is something that a lot of our visitors ask. One of the things that we don't want the men in Islam to be is distracted by the women that will be in front of him. You can just imagine if we have a lot of women in front of the brothers, their focus really wouldn't be that we should wander on what's going on in the masjid versus looking at all of the different women in front of them and how they're different shapes and forms. Amaze them and give them different opinions of what female is like, and take away from his real devotion and concentration on what he's here for.
The chamber for also for older people who may have weak knees and for guests, and there's a lot of body contact in prayer, as you must have seen. And that is why there is gender segregation in the prayer, but we try not to make it in the room. There's a hand up here somewhere. Go ahead.
I had the same question.
Oh my God. Come on, be creative. I thought St. Andrew's kids were creative. Let's get more questions. Then you can add up to it. Go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead. Well, ask. No, you go ahead and ask. There's nothing to hesitate.
Hamad.
No more questions? Yeah.
Sort of a two-part. My name's James.
Andy Isabella.
I have sort of a two-part question.
Okay.
What happens in the afterlife, and what is the purpose of it?
Purpose of afterlife?
Yeah.
And what happens? Okay, let me see. You want to take that, Brother Shahid? Look. The purpose of, it's a very good question. Because we have been so obsessed with what is the purpose of this life, to focus on the purpose of afterlife. The Quran says that the purpose of afterlife is so that God may tell us where we were wrong on this, in this life, and we were right. But consider afterlife as homecoming. As human beings, there are two parts to us. One is the corporeal part, the body, which is 70% water, 30% clay, just like the earth. That's what the Quran teaches us. The rest is our soul, which is the breath of Allah. He breathed life into us, so we are divine in that sense. So that part of His breath is part of us. So life on this earth is an exile from our beloved. So if you love God, and life on earth is being like we have been torn apart from our beloved. We are separated from the one that we love. So the purpose of life after life is reunion. We return to God to be one with Him. That's the purpose, in my understanding of Allah.
Can I add a little bit more?
Sure, sure.
Yes, it's like same like you are going to the school. So after you finish the school, you get reward. You will be getting offer from the different companies for good job, everything. So this life is a test for all of us. Like we have a different beliefs, Muslim, Christian, everybody. But we have to follow the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah, the God, want to see us, how sincere we are. So if we pass the test, we will be rewarded in the hereafter. According to the deeds, the good deed matters. So we are ordered by the Allah, and was told by Allah in the, all the holy books, the same thing. Don't lie, don't cheat, don't harm anyone. So Allah want to see how sincere we are. So according to our sincerity and clean intention, we will be rewarded in the hereafter. And that will be heaven. And for the bad deed, there is a hell. God told us the both sides, hell and heaven. If you follow the rule, you will get this one. Like red light, we follow the rules, we follow the law. If you don't, camera will take your picture, and next day you will get $125. So inshallah, God willing, we should do good whatever our ability is, according to our ability, and we will be rewarded, inshallah, God willing.
What's your second part?
Go
ahead, Dustin.
We recently learned about so-called theodicies, or why, if God is all good, why is there evil? Do you have an explanation for that?
Any time, would you like to take it? If God is all good, why is there evil? It's a very famous theological question.
No, I may not know the answer. I wanted to expand on what was being discussed earlier, so that you don't get too scared about the afterlife. You are too young. So I'm going to basically share this poem that I wrote, which has been published in many places. The title of this poem is Another Chance. Sometimes in my dreams, I see myself on the day of judgment, standing in front of the kind Lord, along with billions of others from all over the world. These are people of all imaginable races, religions, and colors. At one point, they all say, "Dear Lord, we did not do what you wanted us to. We mistreated each other, and we killed people in your name. But our Lord, can you please give us another chance?" In my dream, I hear God replying, "When you were on the earth, I gave you a lot of chances. Now it is time for final judgment. Those of you who were good to your fellow human beings, today you will enter into my paradise." And then all of a sudden, I wake up. I thank the kind Lord. I am still alive and have another chance to help my fellow human beings. Thank you very much.
Salim Khan is our resident poet. Coming back to your question, if you look at verse 1, the chapter 113, Google it, chapter 113, verse 2 of the Quran, it says, قل أعوذ برب الفلق من شر ما خلق. So we are saying we take refuge in Allah from the evil that He has created. Min sharri ma khalaq, from the evil that God Himself has created. Unlike other religions which have a Manichaean posture, the good and bad, God is all good and everything else, there's like another force in universe. I mean, you're watching too much of Star Wars. So there's another force of evil and the force of good. Islam is not like that. In fact, the evil in Islam is personified or reified in Satan. And Satan, according to Islamic history and tradition, was the one who had worshipped God the most. No one had worshipped God more. So Satan is neither a disbeliever, nor can he deny that there is one God, because he actually knows that. He has chatted with God, argued with God, worshipped God. So in Islam, there is no such thing as this is good or that is evil. For God, this world is very trivial. It is not very important. So what may be horrifying and shocking and evil to us, kids going into school and shooting, that is for a way of God testing the rest of humanity. And sometimes we don't understand what the purpose of this is. So this idea that because there are some evil actions performed by some human beings, it is proved that God does not exist, is one of the most ridiculous arguments I've heard, and it comes only from Americans. You know, it's like only Americans are kidnapped by aliens. You know, that's like one of those peculiarities of our culture. So remember this, everything that is good and bad in this universe comes from God. And that is, when you accept that, you have truly submitted to His will. Do you understand? It is submission to God means you have accepted everything that comes. And don't think of evil as something that is created by movies or something like that. Having a tragedy in your life, 2 days ago, it was 17 years since my father died. So to me, that is something that came from God. I look at a lot of people who are in this room who are older than my father. But I accept it. It is a sign of my submission to Him and a sign of my father's submission to Him that we are both good with it. Yes?
I'm Zach.
Zach is a student at the University of Delaware.
You spoke, you used a microphone that was very clear, but during the prayer it was a lot of reverb, and I just wanted to know if that was intentional.
How did God feel?
No, we are struggling, I guess, with our audio systems. If you want to make a donation, we will be happy to accept. But what happened in the prayer was that the sheikh, I was telling him that when he recites the Quran and when I recite the Quran, it is like Mercedes and a bicycle. So in the prayer, he recited the same verses that I was speaking of. So he recited verse 255 and two others that followed in the first part of the prayer. And then he recited from verses 20th till 24th from the 59th chapter, which are all names of God. Yes. Brother Abdullah, you want to take that?
I was comfortable there, but it seemed like everyone else was coming up here, so I didn't want to change the flow. I'm Dr. Abdullah R. Muhammad, and I'm glad you asked the question, because when Muslims enter the masjid, they do the sunnah prayer. This is a prayer, actually a recognition of coming into the prayer, into the masjid. This area we call the musalla. And it is just a tradition, it is just a habit, something that Muslims do to recognize and to give a reverence to where they are and the beginning of the service. It is something that should be done actually quickly. We actually ask some of the members to come early to do it before, but anytime you come, you can submit the sunnah prayer. But do not confuse the fact that the sunnah prayer does not take any precedent over the khutbah that's going on or the prayer that will follow. ceremony.
The obligatory prayer are just those two units which you saw. Some people are performing, like when I come in, I perform two external prayers, actually asking God to help me through the sermon, that I don't say anything foolish, arrogant, silly, stupid in my. And then after that, I also perform two, thanking Him for letting me get through it, hopefully without crisis. People also pray prayers which they have missed in the past, etc. Right, go ahead.
Hello, my name is Dante. I was just wondering what your definition of the word jihad is, because we hear it in the media a lot, but I'm curious to figure out.
Good question.
My definition of jihad is irrelevant. What matters is what the Prophet, peace be upon him, explained us and what the Quran says. The word jihad comes from the Arabic word jahada, which means to say to exert yourself. A lot of things are attributed to the idea of jihad. There are three levels of jihad. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, if you see injustice, stop it with your hands. If you are weak, physically weak, then speak truth to power, use your words. And if you are totally worse, like you can't exert physical force to stop injustice, you can't even speak up against injustice, like you're seeing people being deported and you're not doing anything, then at least in your heart, have the decency to acknowledge that you're witnessing injustice, so that later on the day of judgment, you can testify against the unjust and say, yes, God, I witnessed. So these are the three levels in your heart. So that is one way in which Muslims believe to do jihad, is to fight against oppression. There are verses in the Quran which actually don't use the word jihad, but use the word of khatala, yakhtulu, to fight, to kill. I'm not going to go into the details. I'll send a link. I have done a commentary on all these verses, but they are verses 190 to 195, the second chapter, where God says that basically this is what Muslims are not pacifists. If they are attacked, they can defend themselves. The only circumstances in which Muslims can use force is when they are attacked or they are prevented from practicing their faith. But if the attackers stop the attack, then Muslims have to stop attack. And if the attackers do not oppress you and like do not prevent you to practice your faith, then you cannot use force against them. And finally, even if you are responding to force with force, there are very strict rules on how you respond. You cannot poison wells, you cannot kill children, you cannot kill women, you cannot kill old people, you cannot kill non-combatants. So jihad is Islamic version of just war theory, very similar to that. In fact, the idea of just war theory, especially articulated in terms of Grotius terms, if you are reading Grotius, it actually comes from the theory of jihad, not from Augustine or else. I hope that helps. But I'll send the paper to Terry and he can share it with you.
Thank you.
I'm Lamar. I know one of the five pillars of Islam was pilgrimage to Mecca. I wanted to ask, have you ever been there and what's the purpose of it?
All the Muslims here who have all been to Mecca, please raise your hands. Nearly everybody. It's a rich country. Yeah, what do you want to know more?
Oh, I was saying, how was it? Like, what's the purpose? Like?
My father was in Saudi Arabia when I went there for the first time. So we took a cab from a city called Jeddah, and my father told the cab to stop here, stop here, stop here. I remember him screaming at the driver, about a kilometer away from the mosque. And then when we got down, he told me, close your eyes. And this is one of my best memories with my father. So he told me to close my eyes, and I was at that time 26. He took my hand in his hand, and like father and son walking, and he walked me all the way to the mosque. He told me the steps are coming. Do not open your mouth, eyes, and look down. Then we entered the haram, the mosque. We walked in, and then he said, now listen very carefully. When I tell you to open your eyes, look up, open your eyes, and pray. And that prayer will be answered. So he took me up and he says, now look up and open. And believe me, that was a sight I haven't forgotten. I just looked up, opened my eyes, subhanAllah, the Kaaba was right there. And I'm going to share with you what I prayed, but that prayer did come true within a few years. Yes, go ahead. I'll give you a very quick technical answer. Verse 62 from chapter 2, verse 69 from chapter 5, in which God says, if you are a Jew, if you are a Christian, if you are a Sabian, if you believe in God, if you believe in the day of judgment, and if you do things which are right, you have nothing to fear and nothing to grieve about. When God says you have nothing to grieve, it means about the past, which means he has forgiven your sins. And when he says you have nothing to fear, it's about the future, which means on the day of judgment, he will take care of you. So there are pluralistic statements in the Quran. There is a verse number 384, in which God says that we all follow the same religion of Jacob and Noah and Moses and Jesus. So essentially, the message of Islam is the same message that was sent to all prophets. So the first monotheistic prophet is to Abraham. That's why we call it the Abrahamic tradition. I'm citing these verses because you can go back and then look back, or I can always email those verses from the Quran to you that you take. Okay? The Quran, when it refers to believers, it says Mu'minun, those who believe in one God. So technically, everybody who believes that there is one God is a believer. And then there are specific schools that we follow as Jews, as Christians, as Muslims, as Sabians, and others. Yes, sister.
What do you do if for some reason you can't travel to Mecca?
Who wants to take this? Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, first of all, go to Mecca is an obligation on every Muslim once in a lifetime. And that is if they can afford it, they have the health to be able to make it, and if they're not putting any family or relatives or friends in jeopardy by doing so. So it is not something that you have to feel as a Muslim that you have to do it, but it is something that is obligated to you if you can do it. But if you cannot do it, it's not as though you committed any sin or any aggression or anything of that nature. In fact, in the early days, people would set off months in advance to walk all the way to Mecca because they had, didn't have the money to afford transportation, not even a camel to ride. So they would walk the entire way. Some didn't even look to come back. There are many pilgrims that go, and they never expect to even come back because it's a once-in-a-lifetime journey. I hope that answers your question.
Sometimes you can ask others to pray instead of you. Like, for example, if you have an old mother and a fit son can go and perform the ritual Hajj or Umrah instead of the mother. Sometimes if people die early, you can perform voluntarily saying, oh God, bless me and him, bless me and her, so God may take it as a, count it twice. Yes. I'm wearing a headscarf. So you understand, so you're not asking, you're asking a less controversial question, right? So you don't want to know why women wear it, you want to know why men don't wear it. Oh, okay. Well, it's a tradition out of respect that we wear this cap. If you notice, the cap is exactly like a yarmulke or what the Pope wears. Right, so Muslims, Christians, and Jews also wear very similar caps. It's not a requirement nor an obligation. Like for example, for men, the only thing that is really required is they need to cover themselves from here, from their navel till below their knee. But imagine how we would look if we were praying like that. Sometimes people wear those long shorts and come to Juma. Especially from the khutbah, I can tell you that is not a good idea. Especially when you're sitting. Because it is, if I can get grossed out by that, can you imagine what will happen to angels? Right? So people are told not to smoke and come, not to eat onions and come, basically don't come with body odor, bad breath, dirty socks, because we are so close to each other. So out of respect to each other, we wear tradition. But there's also this research which says that when we dress like religious people, whatever you may think is religious, in fact, this is a Harvard research, probably Terry knows about it, that you imbibe those values. So like, for example, if somebody starts dressing like an imam, over a period of time, his language will become better, and he'll say, oh, I'm dressed like an imam, how can I use four-letter words? And they'll stop using four-letter words. So it's a way of inculcating. And also, it's also a manifestation of different cultures. If you look at what I'm wearing today, I'm wearing clothes from Fez. I bought these in Fez in Morocco. I bought all the caps that were available in the Medina of Fez, and then this dress too. So for me, I had a very good, beautiful spiritual experience in Fez in Morocco. Therefore, whenever I'm doing a sermon, I try to wear that. It has no obligatory character to it.
Also, you have to, I would like for you to take into consideration that God created women to be an attraction to men. And so you have a beauty that men really don't have, that actually, by covering, you actually give a modesty that can be appreciated anywhere you go. So it's more a sense of helping women to be more modest, as opposed to being an outward show of their beauty. Now, I know some of you may think, well, I don't know why I shouldn't show my beauty. Well, there are a lot of examples in society why that is not always a good idea.
This is the second time he has come to this topic. Have you noticed? Go ahead. Yes, Lamar?
Yeah. Why is it that Muslim men cuff their pants?
Cut their pants?
Cuff.
Oh, that's an interesting one. If anybody doesn't know, I know exactly the answer, but sister, do you know? Well, they do that. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you know, there's different traditions in the way that people wear their clothing, so I wouldn't say that you can attribute that to Islam as telling the men to cut their pants. So
there is something that is forbidden, which is arrogance. Only God has the jalal. So, according to some people, there is a tradition which says that when you wear flowing robes, when you robes which are flowing, they are a sign of arrogance which was attributed to the Romans. So when the Romans used to come into Muslim court, they would wear these flowing robes as if, just look at them. Just Google popes from Far East and look at those. I mean, if you are a worshiper of God, don't be so arrogant wearing diamonds and crowns and fancy robes, etc., right? That's why I like the current Catholic Pope. He's so humble. So this sign of wearing long robes was seen as a sign of arrogance, and the prophet therefore said, he also forbid men from wearing gold. Do you see any jewelry on me? Nothing. Doesn't mean I can't afford it. I wear a fit, but no jewelry. Because the prophet said men should wear only that much jewelry, as much as they need to buy one meal. One meal, that's it. So we wear watches, we have cell phones, we can get many meals if you're really starving. So the idea is to make us humble. When we walk the earth, we walk as humble servants of God, not as arrogant pharaohs.
Go ahead. Yeah, he may be also referring to in some tradition, they cuff the pants because it goes back to a time when when Arabs wore their clothing too long, they would get a lot of dirt on their clothing. And when it comes to the masjid, they would bring this sand and dirt into the masjid. So cuffing the pants actually was a sign of keeping the dirt and filth from the outside from coming into the masjid.
Yeah. Okay. We'll take him, and then I'll come back to you, Lamar. Go ahead.
Was there ever like a time where you wanted to leave your religion, and like, if could something that happened to you, and if there was, what made you come back?
This is not a fair question to somebody like me, because I can give you a clever answer, because I don't care about religion, it's about God. How can I ever leave God? How would be so unfortunate? I mean, how can you leave God? God is with you all the time. So this idea that if something bad has happened, you feel disillusioned and tragic. So yes, maybe you feel depressed and pray less, pray more, or do more service. Those things weigh life, but we can't leave God. And that is why it's very important to this sermon. Please keep it in mind. It's not about religion. So what if you are with religion or not with religion? The key question is not that. The key question is, are you with God? And if you are with God, the other chapters will not occur to you at all. Lamar, sure. You are welcome to say something.
No, I just want to make sure.
Getting frustrated or too depressed after a tragedy to the point where even questioning the existence of God and His kindness, it does happen. I know some people close to me who had tragedies, and they went through that phase and then they came back. I have also seen a few situations as a practicing child psychiatrist where I was totally surprised. A 10-year-old is telling me, I do not trust the God. I don't believe in it. I said, why is that? So how could a God do that to a 6-year-old, that he took my mother away from me? And anything that I, any which way I put it to that girl, she would not change her mind at that point. I mean, I don't have the long-term follow-up, but I have seen every now and then some children go through that too.
I just want to share, in Islam we believe that we all come into existence as Muslims. We believe that we all come in submission to Allah when we're born. So we all start out as Muslims. But I was raised in a household that was not Muslim. So I was raised actually in a household that really didn't have much religion. Later on I became Christian, and later on I became Muslim. So I feel that, yes, I have left my religion. I was born a Muslim, and then I left that based on the family that I was raised in that didn't raise me with religious values. And then I came back to Islam as an adult. So yeah, I did, because I was in an environment that I didn't understand what religion was and what Islam was and what Allah and God was. So I've come back to Islam from infancy to conversion later in adulthood. Okay?
There's a verse in the Quran that says, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. He's with you wherever you are. Remember, that is the most important. He will never leave you. Point two.
So there's a lot of internal diversity within Judaism and Christianity that I'm aware of. And I know that there's Sunni and there's Shia within Islam. What other subsets of Islamic faith is there?
This I'm going to do very fast, so follow me, okay? There is a tradition according to which Muslims believe there might be 73 divisions among Muslims. We don't know that. Some people have actually listed them. But Muslims are politically divided. The Shia-Sunni division was a political division, it became theological. Muslims are divided epistemologically, how they interpret religious texts, if they are literalist or expansive in their interpretation. So it goes from being extremely Salafi to being extremely Sufi. There are Muslims who have come up with alternative, where they give a more emphasis to logic over text. So you have modernist Muslims, and then you have really very strict, narrow textual related Muslims. So yes, there are lots and lots of differences. In 2006, Al-Azhar said there were 84 different interpretations of Islam in the city of Cairo alone. So yes, there are things, but the beauty of the faith is that nobody disagrees or disputes the text of the Quran. All Muslims believe in the Quran as we have it, and that is the anchor of our faith. Yes?
I'm Karen. I was wondering how many times a day people pray and like what the meaning behind it is.
Swissman, you want to take that?
So in Islam we have Well, we pray all the time, just like Christians. We can pray to God at any time and ask for what we need, but we have ritualistic prayers that, like you saw today. We pray 5 times a day, and those are at prescribed times. And there was a time when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, may peace be upon him, actually was able, had the direction from God to give us these prayers, and he actually asked that we reduce the number of prayers so that we don't have such a burden on us that we can't manage it. But I think it's a beautiful thing, 5 times a day, I have to stop myself and I have to remember why I'm here. Everything that I do, bismillah, is for the sake of Allah. Bismillah means for the sake of Allah. So that 5 times a day prayer, if you actually stop and say, oh, it's prayer time and I have to stop and remember God right now, you can't forget him all day. He's always there, he's always part of your life. Islam is not just Quran, it's not religion, it's a way of life. So everything that we do goes back to, it's a way of living, and it's a way of constant submission to Allah, constant remembering to submit to Allah.
Go ahead, 1 and 2, and Lamar, I'll come to you. 3, and that'll be the last one.
No, never mind.
You
I'm
can
fine.
Ask.
I'm
don't worry, just because you're wearing a, you're okay, so he can give it to you. Just because you're wearing a green jacket doesn't mean you cannot ask. You can. Go ahead. Oh, yeah. Well, see, it really means the verse that I was talking about in the Quran, we say that everything that exists in the heaven and the earth, which means not just in the created world, but he's talking about angels, etc., he's talking about heavens, have submitted to the will of Allah. And one of the aspects of the will of Allah is, for example, let's say, na'uzubillah, God forbid, let's say you say that I don't believe in God. But when you were born, a white woman, I don't know where you were born, but in America, you already submitted to these aspects of the will of God. He determined where you will be born, what you will be born as. He's already determined when you will die. He's already, we believe, determined how your life will be. So our existence has, you cannot say, okay, I disagree with God and I will choose to die when I want to die, or I will choose to live in a different way. Those things don't happen. The same is true of everything in nature. So in that way, I'm saying ontologically speaking, everything, because it exists, has submitted. The way God creates things is by saying, kun fayakun, be, and they become. God doesn't physically make us. He just say, be, and we become. And when God told us to come into existence, we submitted to his will and came into existence, so we have submitted to him anyway. By virtue of our existence, and our existence proof that we have submitted to him. We'll take these 2 questions and... Okay, go ahead.
I just want to say that many people feel like they don't believe in God, those that accept that. But they don't understand that the first time people come into difficulty, first thing they cry out is, oh God, even though they say they don't believe in God. Or at the time of a great tragedy, they fall down, prostrate on the ground to proclaim, you know, asking for some kind of help or some kind of assistance.
Okay. Yes.
This is a question for you, sister. I was wondering, if you don't mind me asking, what was your reasoning for converting to Christianity?
Told me I couldn't tell you my life story, so I won't, because that's a life story question. But I was before I converted to Islam, I was vice president of women's ministries in a Christian church. I was in charge of feeding the homeless. I worked in the nursery, and there were just certain answers in Christianity that I didn't feel satisfied with. The people that I was close to, I just didn't feel satisfied with some of the things. And when I began to look at Islam, I was seeking. When I began to look at Islam, I felt peace. I felt at home. And when I looked at the way of life of Islam, it answers so many of our problems and issues. If you just look, it's there. It's there. The answers are there for you. Just look for them. And the other thing is the scientific miracles of Quran. If you want to kind of blow your mind, Google some of the scientific miracles of Quran. Mind you, the Quran is the direct word of God, and it was revealed to Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, a man who couldn't read nor write. And yet there are scientific descriptions in Quran that there's no way could have been known 1400 years ago that we know in science just recently, just today, just, you know, in the last 100 years or so, that it's already there in Quran. How could this man write this if you think that it's not the word of God? Where did he get this from? And when you start to realize that, it weighs very heavy, and you're like, you realize you can't deny it. And you get to a point where it's like you have to fall down and accept, you have to submit, because you just cannot turn away. And I think it was, for me, it was the miracles of Quran that sealed the deal for me. Because I struggled with it. Like, I felt like I needed to convert. But hey, I was vice president of women's ministry in a Christian church. So it was very difficult for me to make that submission. I changed, my entire life changed. Alhamdulillah, thanks to God. It's a blessing. But it was the miracles that sealed it for me.
Thank you, sister. I saw one hand here. Green coat. Go ahead.
Hi.
Hi there. Go ahead. They won't scold you at home. Go ahead, finish. Ask the last question and then we'll... Oh, okay. You wanted to ask the same question, Ma? How did it all happen? All right. So thank you very much for coming, Utes. We have a question? A quick one. Go ahead. And we want to end with the president's dua. So go ahead.
Questions that came after each other. One talks about evil and the other one asks about jihad. And I would just see the connection between the two questions is that we have to do jihad if there is evil. And if we don't reform our jihad, then evil will spread and will have more harm. So we as Muslims are directed by God subhanahu wa ta'ala to reform jihad to stop evil, if that's a question.
Thank you.
The other comment about Aisha's and our life is that when we lived in Saudi Arabia, so when we lived in Saudi Arabia, they would look at her and say, what are you doing here? Are you a spy? And when we come and live in the state, they look at me and they say, you're Muslim, are you a terrorist?
Although the Prophet said, be in this world as though you were a stranger. This is not our home. Jannah, paradise.
Thank you all for coming. We have two short statements from the board of the mosque. And I do want to remind you that you're my grand students. Because your teacher is my student. Mm-hmm. Don't forget that.
So for some of you, it may be difficult to conceive why would God create evil, right? So my background is in computer science. And in computer science, there's a discipline called game theory. You heard of that? Game theory? There are two types of games, as we understand as computer scientists. One is called a finite game. A finite game is a game where rules are defined, players are known, and the objective of the game is to win the game. Okay, these three characteristics. So almost all the traditional games that we know, they're finite games. So, you know, football, soccer, you know, name it. Rules are defined, players are known, and the objective is to win the game. The other type of game is called infinite game. Infinite game, the rules can change in the middle of the game. Players can drop out, new players can join in. And the objective of the game is not to win the game. Nobody wins an infinite game. You can only perpetuate that game. make it last long. And when we as computer scientists, in our wisdom, when we design games, some of those games are perpetual games. And in life, there are examples of those perpetual games. For example, a job could be a perpetual, an infinite game. What is the objective? There are no rules defined. Rules can change. There may be rules defined in the beginning, but rules can change in the middle of the game. Players can drop out or join in. A boss may leave, a new boss may be assigned. A number of things can happen. The objective is you can never win a job. You perpetuate it, you make it last long. Relationships. Father-son relationship, mother-daughter relationship, brother-sister relationship, husband-wife relationship, infinite game. Rules can change. Players can drop out, somebody may die, new children may come in, and objective is to prepare. Nobody wins marriage, right? So if we can design games like these in our short wisdom, why can't God design a game that, okay, here it is, here's good, here's evil, and you know, here are initial set of rules. You can bend these rules if you want, but if you bend these rules, these will be my rules, how I will judge. So this is not a far-fetched conclusion to make, that all of this could be based on game theory. Okay, so with that, once again, I thank you for being here. And thank you for the teachers who are doing
it. I'm going down. Yeah, he gave you a review of a movie called Matrix. I would like to invite the president of the masjid, Brother Shahid Bhadwa, to pray for blessings for all of us, and then we will end all Islamic events. Begin with prayer and end with prayer. Thank you.
And before that, I'd like to mention a few more things. God is great. God love you. God love us all. God loves creation. I'm very happy to see you in our mosque. This is not because we want it. This is God wants you to come here. You're a guest of God in His home. So, because of short time, I can give you a few small things, you know, to learn. The efforts, you came to the mosque to satisfy your question, and God is using us to give you answer. Even we don't have this much capability to convince you. Islam cannot be forced to anyone. We are not allowed to do though, but we can invite you. But nowadays, to learn more about Islam is very easy. You know, God will, on the day of judgment, we will be asked, what did you do to find out about me? You know, now look at the same God we pray. You got nose, we got nose. I got nose. You got eyes, I got eyes. You got teeth, I got teeth. Everything is same. So we are created by the same one God, right? So nowadays, if you want to have a more question, it's very easy. Just go to Google. You will be asked. God will tell you. God will ask you. I gave you iPhone 7. What did you do? Yeah. So you can just put why Islam or Islam. Any kind of question you have, you will get answer from there. And I pray, may Allah guide us to the right path. If you have a clean intention, many people, when they embrace Islam, I ask them, what makes you to come to Islam? And everybody have the same question, even different occasion, different people. They told me that we feel that something was missing in our life. You know, something could not be satisfied us. Then they do research. Like one Ayrton, 22-year-old boy, he reaches after 1 year efforts. He got a book on Islam through his school library. Then he went to internet. Then he found some Islamic organization in New York. They gave him our address. Then we go and pick him up, and he was ready to embrace Islam. So I asked him same thing, you know, if your intention is clean, maybe you are misguided by devil or some confusion, something, you know, ask Allah, please Allah, guide us to the right path. I'm not asking you, you must embrace Islam. No, no. Allah wants to see your clean intention. When you want to know one address, what do? You go to GPS. So you go to Allah, please guide us to the, if we are wrong, guide us to the right path. May Allah help you. And thank you very much. Let me pray that Allah guide us to the right path. You came into the masjid, Allah accept your efforts. And Allah guide you and me and everyone. And Allah bless us all. And Allah give us love for each other. No jealousy. Allah may give us a blessing. And Allah give us a chance to learn more about Islam and guide us. And thank you very much. I'm very happy to see you. I love you. On behalf of Masjid Isa, I thank you very much. And you are very welcome to come anytime. And you want to ask any question about Islam, just call us. We are ready. Inshallah, I hope we will see you again. Thank you very much. And your teacher, everyone. God bless you all.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Thank you.